Yeah. We praise you. High and lifted up in all the earth is who you are. High and lifted up. We magnify you. We worship you. You're the only wise God. We glorify you. It's word time. It's word time. I'm not working on brownie points, but it's word time. We thank God for the pastor. Hallelujah. I thank God for the pastor. I thank God that we were like being in Babylonian captivity. You know, maybe there was some Daniels in our midst. Maybe there was some Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. But we needed to come out of. God didn't leave us. He was right there. You know, but we have been like in a situation. But God is stretching us now. When I listen to Bishop Rader, it kind of reminds me when I would listen to Bishop Wagner. I would listen to Bishop Wagner. He would summon the angels and he would do this and he would do. And I would listen to him. I said, will I ever be saved? And sometimes with the knowledge and the insight that the pastor has, we heard it one way, but we're being stretched. Oh! But it's going to take that to get us out of here. And I thank God for it. So this is word time. It's like get rid of the stinky thinking. Renew your mind and let God have his way. Be like birds. You know, you seen the little bitty birds when the mama comes to the nest and they chirping, feed me, feed me. And that's what we want God to do. I thank God for humor. I thank God that if I was a fuzzy wuzzy bear, I would say, I thank you, Lord, that you made me me. But we're going to receive the word and we're going to be enlightened. We're going to be enriched. And we're going to grow, and we're going to be rapture ready, and we're going to be taken out in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye. So word time. Let's receive the pastor. We preach the word. Preach the word.
And it is not for glamour or for notoriety. It is for service. That's what it's all about. Many people think that the ministry is about being served. It's not about being served. It's about serving. Jesus said, the Son of Man came not to be ministered unto or to be served, but to serve or to minister and to give his life a ransom for many. And so that's what our responsibility is, to come and to serve God's people so that when it is all said and done, amen, we'll have a reward. Let me say amen. Amen. That's what it's all about. Amen. I want to give the choir a hand and the praise team a hand, and our musicians doing a fine job. And we do honor the Lord and honor my wife, amen, First Lady Johnson, and also Lady Stewart, who is in our midst, amen, on this morning. Amen. And continue to pray for Bishop Stewart and his family, as well as others that are absent, that are not able to be here. We thank the Lord for your patience. Our sound system is still a work in progress. What we are doing is that we're getting ready for television. That's why we're doing all of this. So we're getting our sanctuary television ready as far as sound is concerned. And we're getting it ready for radio, because we're going to be going live on radio on our Sunday morning services. And so our sound has got to be up to par. And we know what needs to be done. It's just a matter of getting it done. Can we say amen? And so we're going to be having more mics come in. The congregation is going to be mic'd. Praise the Lord. We have more equipment coming in. And this last equipment that will be coming in should get us ready to broadcast our Sunday service live every Sunday, and also to go live at the same time on Facebook, because it don't cost no money to go on Facebook, do it? Praise the Lord. You could probably reach more people on Facebook than you can pretty much on television. But these are the things that we're doing to bring in souls, that souls might be saved. There's other people out there that are looking for Jesus, but they don't know where to find him. Amen. We want them to know he's right over here on 3rd Street. Let me say amen. At the Greater Bethel Temple. So we desire your prayers. We're also in the process of looking to get some new pews, or get our pews refurnished. We have a company that came in and took out one of them, and he's going to fix it up, show us what they're going to look like. They're going to be white, padded in purple. That's what we're looking at right now. And so we desire your prayers. We're going to need everyone to support. If we have 200 people and everyone gave $150 toward these pews, that's $30,000, because the pews are going to cost $36,000. Praise the Lord. It's a lot of money, isn't it? But can you imagine those new pews in here? Can we say amen? Amen. Praise the Lord. And so this is what we're going to be trying to do, and we need to try to raise $30,000, and I believe that God can do it through us if we all have a mind to get it done. Praise the Lord. So we're looking to getting new pews or getting these refurbished. We talked to the man that did them back in 81. He did the pews back in 81, and we called him, and he's going to come and give us an estimate on getting these done. And at the same time, we're going to be getting new carpeting put out there within the pews and all of that. Amen. We're looking for God to do some great things. Is that right? Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. And so I know that getting white pews to match the podium and the walls will kind of make some of the things look like an eyesore. But so we're going to bring all of the wood and everything into conformity so that everything would match very beautifully, so that when the church gets on television, people will say, oh, that place is something else. Now, we already know it's a beautiful place, but God's not finished. Is that right? Amen. So if we all can get together, amen, and raise the funds so that we can get all this done, amen, I believe that God will be glorified, souls will be saved, and the saints of God will be revived, reinvigorated, and encouraged, amen, to see what God is doing through you. Amen. Can we say amen? Amen. Somebody says, wow, he wants to do all that. Well, God wants to do it. And whatever God wants done is going to get done. The question is, are you going to be part of the vision? Are you going to be part of the blessing? Are you going to allow the Lord to use you? Because if you don't allow him to use you, he's going to use somebody. Can we say amen? He's going to use somebody. It might as well be you. And the church say amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. So we have about 10 baptism and Holy Ghost certificates to give out. We're going to do that at the end of service. Praise the Lord, because we have some here that have recently been saved and gone down in Jesus' name.
And we're going to keep on going until this place is completely overflowing. Amen. And we'll see what the Lord has for us in store after that. Amen. The work continues. Is that right? Amen. So we're not going to hold you long this morning. We want to encourage you about the Christian Women's Conference that will be going on in the month of March. We want you to come and support that. Evangelist Williams and the sisters are doing a fine job. Amen. All these services are designed for people to be saved, This is what it's all about. And we just don't want our own color to be saved. Can we say amen? We want all races of people to come through the doors of this church, go down in Jesus' name, and God fill them with the Holy Ghost. Amen. As we go on with the Lord. So today we're going to call your attention to 1 Corinthians chapter 7. 1 Chronicles chapter 7. Amen. And we're going to preach. Praise the Lord. Is that the right scripture? Lord have mercy. I done called the wrong scripture again. I think we want 2 Chronicles. Yes, I'm sorry. 2 Chronicles chapter 7. And we are preaching part 2 of the sermon on last Sunday. This house is a house of sacrifice. So in case you missed it last Sunday, then you'll get part 2 on today. Can we say amen? Amen. 2 Chronicles chapter 7 and verse number 12. And I'm going to read verse 12 down to verse 16. And those that can stand, we're going to ask you to stand. If you have difficulty standing, you can just relax there and read along with us. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. I saw Pastor McFeeters here. Is he still here? Oh, he must have took off. We're going to recognize him. You saw him earlier here. He was sitting in most of the service, so perhaps he had to go. 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse number 12. And the Lord appeared to Solomon by night and said unto him, I have heard thy prayer and have chosen this place to myself for an house of sacrifice. If I shut up heaven that there be no rain, or if I command the locusts to devour the land, or if I send pestilence among my people, if my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and heal their land. Now mine eyes shall be open and mine ears attend unto the prayer that is made in this place. For now have I chosen and sanctified this house, that my name may be there forever, and mine eyes and mine heart shall be there perpetually. Amen. I want you to repeat after me, but when it comes to this house and this verse, I want you to say Greater Bethel. Can we say amen? All right, let's read. For now have I chosen and sanctified Greater Bethel, that my name may be there forever, and mine eyes and mine heart shall be there, what? Perpetually. This house is a house of sacrifice. Come on, give the Lord a hand as you go to your seat. God bless you. Amen on this morning. Of course, as you read earlier in this chapter, you will find that in the building and dedication of Solomon's temple, which was the finest temple in the world at that time. It took him 20 years to build this temple. And it was something that the world had never seen before this time. He built this temple so that God would have a place to dwell in. He built this temple so that God could have a beautiful edifice that he can come and be among his people. God was not dwelling in the hearts of men back in those days. The scripture says, as he told Moses, or he told David, should I say, that he had always walked and dwelt in a tent. But it came into David's heart that he wanted to build God a house. He recognized how the Lord had blessed him and his beautiful house that he was living in, but the house of God was still dwelling in curtains, still dwelling in, praise the Lord, in the form as when Moses first had it constructed out there in the wilderness. hundreds and hundreds of years ago. And so he felt that in as much as that he was living in a beautiful house, that God ought to have a beautiful house. Can we say amen? Amen. And of course, Solomon was the one that was able to bring David's vision to pass. Praise the Lord, because David passed his vision on long to his son. And his son took the vision that his father gave him and ran with it. God had told David that, praise the Lord, I know you want to build me a house, and I know you want to do some great things for me, but you are a man of war. I can't allow you to do it. Praise the Lord. But your son Solomon, who will rise up after you, he will be the one, amen, that I would use to be able to build a house for me to dwell in. And praise God. And so we see here in the seventh chapter, praise God, that Solomon is praying and dedicating the house of God that he constructed that took him 20 years to build. Much sacrifice went into building this building. A lot of manpower, a lot of hours of people working, praise God, to build God a house. Amen. This monstrosity, amen, of a temple, of the finest that has never been seen or had never been done before in the history of the human family. Praise the Lord. And there's a lesson in us in seeing that, because Solomon never would have been able to accomplish what he accomplished if it had not been for David, his father. It was because of David's relationship with God that it was passed on to his son, and that his son was able to do, amen, all of the things that was in the heart of his father, because God, through David, had placed those same desires in the heart of his son. Can the church say amen? Amen. It seems like that, praise God, he couldn't have come up with this all by himself. It was because of what his father had deposited in him based upon his relationship with God. We all know the story about the life of David, how he was called a man after God's own heart. He made a lot of mistakes. He messed up at times. Amen. But the difference between David and most people, that when he messed up, amen, he owned up to his mistakes. He repented and he acknowledged, amen, his transgression, as the scripture says, and his sin was ever before him. That's what made him special in the sight of God. Amen. Not so much that, praise God, that he was a person that never made a mistake, but he was a person that made a mistake and tried his best never to make the same mistake twice. Can the church say amen? You see, it's not so much about the mistakes that you make, praise God, as what you do after you made the mistakes. Tells the difference between, amen, a successful person and an unsuccessful person. I remember I was watching Inside the NBA, and amen, Shaquille O'Neal was talking about, amen, how he had to learn how to win. And he said that when he and his team got blown out, swept out of the playoffs by Michael Jordan and the Chicago Bulls, he said Michael Jordan gave him this piece of advice and said, in order for you to learn how to win, you first of all have to learn how to lose. And he said, once you learn how to lose, amen, then you will be able to learn how to win. Amen. Praise the Lord. Can we say amen? Amen. Solomon learned. Amen. David learned, amen, from his mistakes. He learned from his errors. And that's why he rose to the height, amen, in the heart of God, as to being a man after God's own heart. Amen. I don't know about you, but I want to be a man after God's own heart. I know you ought to want to be a woman after God's own heart. Amen. David said on one occasion, if you are to mark all of my iniquities, praise God, who can stand? If you was to mark every man's iniquity, everything that he's done wrong, who could stand before you? But we don't serve a God like that. We serve a God, amen, that is a God of a second chance. Can the church clap in and shout hallelujah? Because David, in spite of his errors and in spite of his mishap and in spite, praise God, of his messing up, he was still able to get back up, amen, and worship God and give God the glory and give God the praise. Normally, when you think about David, you only think about his affair with Bathsheba. Can the church shout hallelujah? Amen. But that was just, amen, one scenario, one, praise God, incident in his whole life. Amen. If it had not been for David, there would be no Solomon. If it had not been for David, there would never have been, amen, a Solomon's temple where God can walk in and dwell among his people, and his people and the entire world, amen, can come and see this temple and say, that's God's house. because his house is not like any other house. His temple is not like any other temple. Yes, they had temples of Baal. They had temples of Ashtoreth. They had temples of Horus. They had temples of the god of the pagan nations round about them. But there was one house established in Jerusalem that God said, my name is there. Come on, clap your hands and shout hallelujah. Oh, yes. Thank God, amen, for King David. Thank God that, amen, when he fell with Bathsheba, that wasn't the end of the story. Thank God when he messed up, amen, that was not the conclusion of his life. Amen, because I heard him say in Psalms number 51, amen, he said, against thee and thee only have I sinned. He said, wash me and make me clean, create in me a clean heart. And renew within me a right spirit. I want to say to somebody here today that God wants to give you a second chance. Don't matter what you did last night. Don't matter what your cousin said about you. It doesn't matter what your mama said about you. He's a God of a second chance. Your end is not, amen, what you did on the other day. Amen. You can have a new beginning. If David had a new beginning, you can have a new beginning. Come on, clap your hands and shout hallelujah. Glory. Come on and say hallelujah. Praise God. Doesn't matter what you did in the past. Huh? You might have been locked up in a prison somewhere. You might have done some terrible things. Huh? But we serve a God, amen, that is able to forgive. A God that is able to wash all your sins away. A God that went to Calvary for you and died for our sins. Amen. Because he knew what we would be. He knew what would happen. He knew how we were raised. He knew about the peers that were around us. But thank God, as Paul said, by grace are you saved through the gift of God. His mercy endures forever. His mercy endures forever. Come on, clap your hands and shout hallelujah. Oh, yes. Come on and say hallelujah. Amen. So David, because he got back up and because he learned from his mistakes, amen, he was able to get back up and keep on running, amen, for Jesus. Praise God over Jehovah, his God. And the church shout hallelujah. And praise God as he entered into his heart to want to do something for the Lord. Entered into his heart. He wanted to be a blessing to God. He looked at all of the things that God had done for him. How God had been so good to him. Amen. He just wanted to do something special for him. And the church shout hallelujah. I don't know if you know what that feels like. Amen. When you look back over your life, like the songwriter said. Amen. And look at the things. Amen. In your past. As the songwriter says, when I look back over my life, I can truly say that I've been blessed. And the church shout hallelujah. All of the things I did in the past, amen, I can say that I am truly blessed. Because I shouldn't be here on this Sunday morning. I should be locked up somewhere. Some of y'all ought to be in the crazy house somewhere. Some of y'all ought to be 6 feet deep somewhere. But when I look back and see where he brought me from, I can truly say I'm blessed. I'm blessed. I'm blessed. Hallelujah. Come on and shout hallelujah. Come on and say hallelujah. Well, King David, he wanted to do something for God. God told him you couldn't do it. Hold on there, brother. You can't do it, David. And you got a son that's coming. And I'm going to allow him to do what you want to do in your heart. And so David began to prep, amen, his son Solomon. He began to educate him about the things of God. And that's how he was able, amen, to rise up. And once he got in the position of the king of God's people, he assembled all of the things that David had prepared for him. And he was able to build God a house. Come on, clap your hands and shout hallelujah. I'm going to say hallelujah. What's the moral behind this story? our children could be a lot better if we put the faith that we have in God in the hearts of our children. God has done some great things. Many of you all that are here, but you got to put them in your children so that they can build God a house when they come of age. I thank God for Annette Johnson, who in 1969 stepped out of the Kojic church and went to an apostolic church. And when the altar call came, she got up from her chair and walked down to Bishop Halton, and he laid hands on her, and God filled her with the Holy Ghost as she went down in the name Jesus. That was in 1969, and here I am, 2016. I thank God for a mother that taught me that Jesus can be your best friend. I'm so glad I had a mother prayed for me and said, when your heart is overwhelmed, lead you to the rock that is higher than I. I'm so glad I had a mother that taught me there was one Lord, one faith, one baptism. Oh, what is a blessing to have a saved mother. Oh, what a blessing to have a saved father. I'm here today. Some of y'all are here today because mama prayed, daddy prayed, sister prayed, told you about Jesus. Clap your hand and say, yeah. Hallelujah. I'm almost finished. Well, we get to Solomon, and the Bible tells me that he builds this temple, and it took him 20 years to build God's house. And the Bible tells me that he offered all these sacrifices. Lord, have mercy. In verse number 5, the Bible says Solomon offered a sacrifice of 20 and 2,000 oxen and 120,000 sheep. That's why no wonder God said it was a house of sacrifice, because that's what his house is all about. David's sacrifice to live for God. Solomon's sacrifice to build God a house. And that house was reflected of you and I. But number one, it was reflected of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Because he was the fulfillment of Solomon's temple. He was the ultimate sacrifice that was offered for our sins. Come on, clap your hands and shout, thank you. Come on and say hallelujah. And our Lord has showed us what it means to sacrifice. And the church shout hallelujah. He was the master of what it is to be a sacrificer. He was the one that taught us. He was the one that showed us. He was the one that was our example of what a sacrificer should be. I heard him tell the disciples, my meat is to do the will of him that sent me. I heard the Lord saying, I came into the world to die. Clap your hand and say, yeah. I'm almost finished. Come on and say, yeah. He was born as a sacrificer. He couldn't be bothered about getting married.
He couldn't be bothered with a girlfriend. He couldn't be bothered going to U of L or getting his degree. He had one thing in mind, to be the sacrifice for the sins of the world. Clap your hand and say, yeah. Say yeah. And you all know the story. How he was born. You know the story of the miracles he did. You know the story how he was betrayed in the hands of sinners. He was bought and sold like a slave on the market. And when he went to Calvary, he had been beaten all night long. Come on and say yeah. They spit on him. Y'all don't hear me. Come here, Jesus. Come to church, your hallelujah. Come here, brother. And let me illustrate to you what the sacrifice did for you. Beat on him there. Come on and beat on him. They whipped him. Bow your head like you're getting whooped all night long. Is that what y'all read? Clap your hand and say, yeah. Hallelujah. They beat on him. They knocked him down. They kicked him. They spit on him. They stripped his clothes. Take off his jacket. Stripped his clothes. We didn't complain. What did he say? I am the sacrificer. Come on and say yeah. Get him up. And they picked him up and put him on the cross. Didn't they? So he didn't murmur. He didn't complain. He didn't say, why me? What was he doing? I am a sacrificer. My body is a sacrificer. I gotta show y'all what it means to be a sacrificer. Clap your hand and say yeah. Hallelujah. Let the church shout hallelujah. Well, thank God the sacrificer laid in the grave, and on the third day, you see, you can't keep a sacrificer locked away forever. Y'all don't hear me. You can't hold a sacrifice down. The devil can't stop you from your sacrifice. He can't stop you. He may try, but I heard somebody say, no weapon formed against us can prosper. Thank you, brothers. They couldn't keep the sacrifice down on the third day. What happened on the third day? What happened on the third day? It was a Sunday like no other Sunday. The sacrificer stood up out of the grave. A sacrificer went through the stone. A sacrificer appeared and said, I was dead. I'm alive forevermore. And the sacrifice is on the throne right now. What am I saying? I beseech you, therefore, brother, that you present your body, a living sacrifice. Because he showed us the example. Because he said to Solomon, my house shall be a house of sacrifice. This is how this church was built. This is what brought us where we are today. Some of y'all ain't sacrificed in a long time. But God is telling you today, Solomon built that house on a sacrifice. David gave him all the materials as a sacrifice. He offered sacrifices. Jesus gave his life as a sacrifice. That's why Paul said that we need to present our bodies a living sacrifice. Give Jesus your Tuesday and come to prayer. Give Jesus your Friday and come to Bible class.